Hello, Robert.
Hey, Peter, how are you?
Good.
Where are you?
I'm in Chicago at the World Headquarters of Education Post.
The New York office of the Thomas B. Fordham Institute has recently moved locations. It used to be located in my dining room. It's now located in my kitchen.
Wow. Was there a budget for that relocation, or was this?
No, I financed it out of pocket.
All right. All right, folks, I think we're ready to begin a little late. I'm sorry for the delay, everybody. We had some technical problems. My name is Bob Bowdon. This is a Choice Media broadcast. We will have a discussion or debate, if you want to call it that, between Robert Pondiscio of the Fordham Institute and Peter Cunningham of EdPost. If you want to live tweet questions for these proceedings, you can use the hashtag EdAutonomy. And that actually leads us to the title of this event, How Much Autonomy? Meaning sometimes it's framed as accountability versus autonomy. How much regulation should schools have if they receive public money to help educate kids? This has been a subject of some back and forth posts by a bunch of people, but our two panelists in particular. And so I wanted to kind of start things off with some questions, and I guess Mr. Pondiscio had written maybe some of the first material that started this back and forth, and so I wanted to just get you to opine on that, Robert. The question of how much regulation should schools have?
How much time do we have, Bob? Because this could take all night. You know, for me, it's less of a question of how much regulation than how much regulation do those of us who are not low-income parents have to abide in order to educate our children. You know, the answer for families like mine, and I guess for Peter's as well, is not very much. So let's start with that. But I also come at this from the perspective of, you know, less of a policymaker and more of a teacher. I'm staunchly pro-accountability. I left my you know, nice office job 15 years ago to teach in the South Bronx and never quite went back to it. So I'm, you know, very much pro-choice, pro-charters, pro-accountability. That said, I always say I've got a very complicated relationship with all this stuff. It's simply not possible to have set foot inside of a school in the last 10 or 15 years and not be aware of the degree to which the accountability tail is wagging the schooling dog. So the question of how much accountability interests me, I will confess, slightly less than how is the accountability that we have working, and what effect is it having on schools? I've argued for some time right now that we may need to uncouple testing and accountability. The more time goes on, the more firm I become in that viewpoint. So it's not as if I'm suggesting that we just you know, pull the plug on all of this and say to every kid in America, you know, hey, here's a backpack full of money, go buy yourself some education. That said, if we were to do that, I'm not sure that we would get results that are worse than what we've got right now.
Peter Cunningham.
Well, I concede that in a lot of ways that the accountability system we have is flawed, that it has contributed to over-testing, to test prep. But I always put that up against what the absence of accountability would be like. And I've only been sort of in the school reform world for about 15 years at the local level and at the federal level. And I'm very much part of the last 15 years of education reform, which, you know, really began with No Child Left Behind. But I do know that whenever I talk to people about what schools were like in the 70s and 80s and 90s, before there was accountability, it's pretty grim what they talk about. They talk about schools, lots and lots of schools with very, very low graduation rates and lots of kids who really graduate without, you know, even basic skills. And so I think that for whatever flaws the accountability system has, the absence of it, I think, would be a lot worse. So I think the job is to continue to figure out how to do it better.
I guess one question I would have for both of you is whether, to some degree, you're both moderates in this regard, in that Mr. Cunningham would not have zero school choice or zero parental input, and Mr. Pondiscio would not have zero regulatory oversight. So, Peter, let's start with you on that. Like, you do support school choice, right?
I support high quality charters. I'm a little conflicted about, or mixed about, vouchers. But I do support high quality charters. I'm troubled by the wide variation in quality in the charter sector. I think it's killing the charter sector. I think it's really facing the death of a thousand cuts. We just see story after story, year after year, on you know, low performing schools, schools that close down quickly, schools that aren't well managed. And then you compare that with the great ones that do a great job. And I just wish we had more of the good ones and fewer of the bad ones. And somehow we need systems to encourage more good ones and to discourage more bad ones. Now, I would add that there's even more accountability in the charter sector than there is in the traditional sector. So, I mean, they actually do close down schools.
And just to dial in a little on that, you say killing the charter sector, but if you look at the growth charts, you see more children and more charter schools every year in the charter sector. So, killing how?
Well, I think it's just undermining the narrative around it. I mean, I'm sort of in the communication side of this, not the policy side of this. And I think that there's a very, very, there's continuing pushback against it. I mean, we just saw the very best charter schools in the country get voted down in Massachusetts over what I think were somewhat false issues. But nevertheless, people are receptive to the idea that, yeah, they're stealing money away from the system, and, yeah, they're not as good as they were. And I think that there's a lot of people who look broadly at it. And the research shows, and broadly speaking, they're not a whole lot better. The good ones are. The great ones are. They aren't all.
Certainly from a messaging point of view, I think you make a point about the, you know, the John Oliver HBO anti-charter comedy bit and the NAACP vote and things like that. So there were some certainly challenges this year in terms of – actually, both you guys, could you have a lot of headroom in the shot, as we say in the world of cameras. Maybe you can tilt the laptops a little bit. So Robert there diving in. So, Robert, let me ask you then about where you are on this continuum. So you're not for zero regulation, right?
To me, the question is, I'm less interested in the question of how much regulation is appropriate than our over-reliance on it at this point. So rather than, you know, diagnose it, I just want to kind of talk about what I see from my perspective inside the classroom. And, you know, Peter, you said something interesting about, and nobody would disagree with this on its surface, you're in favor of high-quality charters. I mean, nobody's in favor of poor-quality charters. But isn't that the dichotomy that you just pointed out, high-quality charters versus poor ones that are damaging the charter sector, isn't that the best argument for loosening the regulation? In other words, the best charters that we have, the Success Academies, the KIPPs, the Achievement First, Democracy Prep, where I teach, I would argue that we are not good because we have the heavy hand of authorizers over our heads. By the same token, what good is the heavy-handedness of authorizers doing for those bad charter schools? So in other words, we have the regulatory systems that you would seem to advocate, but they're not working. So at some point, shouldn't that say to us, let's consider some alternatives here?
Well, I'd say they're not working in some places. I think they're working in others, aren't they?
But are they working? In other words, are the KIPPs and Successes and Uncommons of the world, are they working because of the regulatory agencies over them? I have my doubts.
I couldn't actually tell you. I think they are. I think it's a factor. I think if they had a high bar for admission into the charter world, that would be a good thing. I mean, ultimately, are we just relying on the goodwill of charter operators? I think that's not a great public policy to rely on.
I don't dispute that, but if the argument is that we need regulatory agencies to prevent bad charters from happening, well, we have both of those right now. So
right, but we don't have great ones, Robert. You know that. I mean, they vary tremendously. Michigan has 41 different authorizers. You have authorizers in upstate Michigan authorizing schools in Detroit. How is that a sensible way to do things?
But how is it less sensible than, say, and again, I don't want to use the extreme example of here's $15,000, kid, go buy yourself some education. But where I guess I'm at this point is I'm having a difficult time understanding how that would be worse than what we have right now. Take, for example, urban Catholic schools, which, you know, for many, many years have been, and I know you, I'm taking your point that you say you were dubious about vouchers. I've had a long road to get to the point where I'm not just in favor of them, but strongly in favor of them. Even these great charters that you and I both lionize are arguably not as strong as the Catholic schools that they have largely replaced. Would we be better off as a nation if we allowed low-income families in our inner cities and elsewhere to attend those Catholic schools on public dollars and schools like them.
I really don't know whether we'd be better off. I think we have evidence that some Catholic schools are great. I don't know that they all are, but we also have concerns about schools that are starting to bleed into church and state and whether they're teaching religion and where does that end and where does that begin. Mm-hmm. And so if these Catholic schools want to create a charter school and segregate the teaching of the religion from the rest of it, I think certainly that's something we can look at or some people look at it. I'm just trying to make the point that I think you need regulation. I think that we see it in not just here, you see it in every industry. You know, yeah, we have an EPA because industry doesn't police itself. We have the SEC because Wall Street doesn't police itself. And similarly, when we have a charter sector, if we just let anybody open a school and anybody do what they want in the school, we're going to have a lot of bad schools and those are going to have consequences for kids.
But you know, when I wrote the piece, and Bob, sorry to cut you out of this conversation. this is your show, not mine.
No, this is a good host gets out of the way.
Okay, you know, Peter, the piece that I wrote for U.S. News, basically saying, hey, why don't we let poor people decide, just like you and I get to decide whether you know by opting out of the public system or by moving into a community with good schools. You know, one of the you took that argument apart piece by piece, and that's fine. But the one piece of it that you did not address, I think, was my Pell Grant argument. So, you know, and I'll grant you at this point, I'm probably further along the lines of accepting broad latitude for vouchers and ESAs and scholarships and whatnot than likely you are. But if your concern is that we can't have public dollars going to religious schools that may, heavens forfend, preach at kids, well, we already do that, don't we? In other words, public dollars go to Pell Grants. Yeah, so the principle is in place. In other words, if we agree, and I'm assuming we agree, that the public's interest is served by a well-educated citizenry, then should it matter to us whether or not that good education happens in a Catholic school, in a private school, or someplace else? Let parents choose the values that matter to them. I'm just taking you at your word. If your concern is about accountability, then let's have accountability, but open it up to Catholic schools and let the parents decide that they want that flavor of education.
Well, I think that we have a long history of believing that church and state should be separated. And these are state schools, state in the small s sense. And I still think that that's probably a good idea in the long run to keep that separate.
Yeah, and I guess my counter to that would be a good idea if kids could read.
I'm with you on that, Robert.
At this point, I think I would much rather worry about having a well-educated citizenry as our first concern, and who does it under whose roof and on whose nickel. That to me is a secondary concern at best.
Okay. Well, let's just draw that a little bit, Peter. There was the Zelman decision where the U.S. Supreme Court said that money to families could be used at religious schools through a voucher, and that was adjudicated by the court as not a problem with church and state separation, a phrase which does not occur in the Constitution, by the way. Are you uncomfortable with Pell Grants being used at Notre Dame, for example? Are you, where do you stand on that?
I think I'm fine with that. I think these are higher ed, it's a slightly different world, but I understand that there is philosophical inconsistencies in allowing vouchers in Pell Grants going to all kinds of schools. Those schools are religiously affiliated. Whether they're teaching religion in the classroom, perhaps is something, depends on what the kids are studying, but certainly they're religious institutions. I think I said before that if there are Catholic schools that want to set up charter schools, maybe there are rules that can be set up so that there's, you know, so there's separation between teaching the religion and not. I think it's fine what happens at the higher ed. I don't think the same issues apply. I think that it's a different situation. And as I said, this was all about whether we need regulation or whether we need no regulation. And to me, it seems to me we need regulation. We need them at the higher ed level as well. So,
well, again, I don't think either of you are arguing complete and total, zero parental involvement or choice, and neither of you are arguing zero regulation. But Robert, let me ask you, are you concerned at all by, are there any marketplaces, whether it's Michigan charters or some places where you feel that you know, whether it's vouchers or charters, there's eventually some sort of group of people, whether it's an authorizer or called something else in the case of a state with vouchers, some sort of group that determines which schools are eligible for the public money that, you know, not just, you know, my brother-in-law, Jimmy, you know, has got his, you know, school, you know, he's going to use the voucher money for tequila and hookers, and there's no one checking. You know, are there any examples where you look at too little regulation? Is Michigan one?
I'm out of my depth on the specifics of Michigan. I mean, I've spent every day as a teacher. I've spent it here in New York, so that's the one that I know best. You know, look, I guess these questions are interesting to debate theoretically, but as a practical matter, I don't think we're going to get there. So the question is not, or if the question is, would you rather have the regulations we have or none? If those are my only two choices, I'll take none. But those are obviously not my only two choices. My concern is when the regulations become so burdensome that we de facto close off productive avenues for kids. In other words, Peter was talking about wanting, well, if Catholic schools want to set up charter schools, and I assume he meant secular charter schools, well, why not allow children to attend garden variety regular Catholic schools? Again, as best as I can figure, and I speak as somebody who teaches civics, the public's interest is not in anything other than a well-educated citizenry and preparing kids to take their responsibilities in self-government seriously. There's nothing in a Catholic school education that would get in the way with that as far as I can tell. So I'm perfectly comfortable with saying let's send kids to the good Catholic schools that we have. I mean, subject for another day, but the loss of good Catholic schools in this country, it has been nothing less than a tragedy in American education, not for Catholics, but for America. You know, these schools educated generations of working class and inner city youth and did a very, very good job. So I see no reason to say, well, we're uncomfortable with you doing this because, you know, you've got a, you know, you're a religious school. The other thing too, I think that we haven't talked about is if we were able to release the reins of regulation more, what would it do to K-12 as a sector? About the last thing that I want to do is to be seen as promoting online education and online charter schools. You know, the argument is they have been of very low quality, and that is absolutely true. That said, there is nothing to say that they must be low quality. So if we were able to free up more dollars to allow real innovation in education, would we start to see better online charters? Would we start to see different models? One of the problems with the regulatory structure saying, look, it's reading, it's math, it's nothing else, is it tends to reinforce what we already have as opposed to encouraging, you know, new forms of schools and new models. So that's, in other words, you can look at the evidence of how these things work and say, well, look, it hasn't worked. But unless we, you know, blow off the doors, maybe that's an extreme metaphor, but unless we allow for a lot greater innovation and experimentation than we have, we don't know what could work.
Do you think that we've done reading and math and nothing else?
Yeah, I don't want to overstate the case, but yeah, I think it's very, very difficult to, you know, as soon as you tell a school, a teacher, a district that we're expecting a year's growth in a year's time in reading, look, as somebody who knows literacy quite well, I literally cannot tell you what that means. I don't want to get down in the weeds in literacy, but it is the subject I know best. It is cumulative. In other words, every experience that a child has from the day he or she comes home from the hospital to the day he sits down in front of a test builds background knowledge, builds vocabulary. It is not an incremental year-over-year hierarchical subject the way, say, math or science or history might be. So what you do when you demand those kinds of results, or else, you know, under threat of censure or closure, is you tell teachers functionally, look, work on skills. And I should make air quotes when I say reading skills, because there's really no such thing. So you take away rich curriculum, you disincentivize background knowledge and vocabulary, you encourage the test prep that I think both you and I agree, Peter, is deleterious to kids. So we've been doing that for so long that by now, I think we're starting to get the message that doesn't work. But unless you release schools and teachers and districts from that idea of a year's growth in a year's time, whether it's growth or proficiency that you're valorizing, you're functionally damaging reading proficiency. So at the very least, we have to stop doing what's not working.
Well, I would argue that it's not working. I would argue that it doesn't work perfectly like everything in the world, but I think it does tell us our kids learning some of these basic skills. It tells you something. Tests tell you something. They don't tell you everything. But a college, an ACT test where a kid gets in the 30s tells you something about a kid where another kid gets an 18 or 19. You can pretty well assume that one kid is a little more ready than the other for college level work. Is it perfect? No. The narrowing of the curriculum has certainly happened. Has it happened everywhere? Has it happened to the exclusion of all else? I mean, a lot of schools still have music, they still have art, they still have civics. You still teach civics. So I just think we've sort of allowed ourselves to think that we've taken it to its logical conclusion. There's only reading and math. I just don't think that's true in most places.
Well, I can tell you where it's definitely not true. It's definitely not true in the schools where you and I send our children. When I chose a private school for my daughter.
My kids went to a public high school.
Okay, but the last thing that would have occurred to me to look at would have been test scores. You just assume that every child can read. So then you start to look at things like sports programs and arts and class size, facilities, on and on and on. So this is where this really gets uncomfortable for me, is whether we like to admit it or not, whether we want to call it paternalism or something else, we are functionally making these demands of schools for other people's children. We are rarely making these demands on the schools to which we send our own children.
Let me break in here, and there's to many where it's something of an inflection point with the new Trump administration and the prospect of Education Secretary DeVos coming in. And I wanted to get thoughts from you two gentlemen on this discussion of a fissure or a divide in the education reform establishment. Into two pieces, whichever you want to call establishment. Robert, you wrote a piece talking about conservatives becoming disenfranchised based on a New School Venture Fund event that you went to. And Education Post has also responded quite strongly to that. I guess I wanted to start with Peter on that. What do you think about this issue of, you know, are there separate aspects of education reform these days, and might those divides become further separated in the months ahead?
So Robert just made the point that a lot of people in education reform are making decisions for other people's children. Now, a lot of those other people are people of color, and a lot of those people of color have for a long time been seeking to be empowered in this conversation. And among education reform circles, it's been pretty clear that we haven't done a good enough job to diversify it. So what happened was you had one panel at one conference talking about some issues that some people of color were very animated about. Black Lives Matter and structural racism and police abuse and issues that were finding their way into classrooms, issues that were reflected in other dimensions of the education system, like over-disciplining of kids of color. And I was not at the event, but some people who work with me were, and they wrote about it, and they celebrated, and they thought it was a good thing. As you know, Robert wrote a piece responding, saying that I worried that this will drive conservatives out of the movement, and a debate ensued. I still think that opening up the tent to a lot of people who have not been part of this conversation is important. And once we open up the tent and invite everybody in and make it something that's very inclusive, there are going to be conversations that go outside our normal comfort zone. And that's good. And I think that's what happened. I don't think it's going to pull apart the entire movement. I don't think it's nearly as high risk as that.
Yeah, my concern was exactly the opposite, which was that we were not opening the tent but closing it. Look, for you know, every child that I've ever taught has been a low-income child of color. That's the work that I signed up for. So I find it at least somewhat ironic that I'm now associated with the opposite viewpoint. But having said that, to me, my concern was exactly the opposite. It's not about opening the tent but closing it. In other words, I'm not sure how ed reform as currently defined has become by, for, and about urban schools, low-income kids of color, but as a practical matter, it seems that we're there. Bob, you alluded to the question too in Massachusetts, and I would argue that the reason that that went down to defeat was because of that, because the ed reform brand, as it were, has become perceived as an urban thing for low-income kids of color, not for Americans. Look, if we learn nothing else in November, it's that there are boxcar numbers of kids out there who are downwardly mobile, who are white, and whose schools are probably not very good. I'm not sure we've been talking to that audience very much. And I think that's a misstep and an oversight on our part.
Let me just get to a tweet, by the way, that came in. It says, "R. Pondiscio is extremely confident in system. Many groups can't afford to be so trusting. Not sure there is too much regulation." Vessia writing, "Not sure there's such a thing as too much regulation." What do you say to that, Robert?
I'm not sure I understand the tweet. In other words, am I being accused of arguing that there's no such thing as too much regulation? Because if that's the case, I think I have been misunderstood.
I think this person is telling you that we could have more regulation and there's not a concern over too much because regulation is always good because it finds bad things and gets rid of bad things.
Yeah, but the point I made before is also true. It also keeps good things from coming into the world. The Uber model has been overused as a model, but it's worth using it because it's one everybody's familiar with. If you say that only, like here in New York City where I am, that only yellow cabs with medallions can operate taxis, then there's no such thing as Uber, and then we spend more money for and that market is tightly controlled. I'm a capitalist. I confess it. I suppose I look at every other line of good and service that we have in this country, and I look at the huge gains that have been made worldwide in terms of life expectancy, health, general well-being, because of open markets and a retreat of regulation. I'm just not sure why we think that education will be the lone exception.
Okay, let me get back to the other issue. And Peter, I wanted to ask you just a little more on this issue of whether the movement has a divide. And I guess the way I would frame it is, if you bring the Black Lives Matter debate into education reform and say that that's needed and say that that affects real children's lives, might you also say a gun control debate is needed to be had in education reform circles, or how to deal with drug laws debate should be included in? A number of just various kinds of social issues, which are very important. No one would say they aren't. But at some point, you could kind of begin to frame a certain set of ideas that are kind of the correct ideas with issue by issue, starting with Black Lives Matter, maybe. And if people fall outside the set of ideas of whatever you think with guns and whatever you think with drug laws and whatever you think, should be taught about global warming and whatever you think about a lot of other things, what schools should say about sex ed, that you end up kind of creating wedge issues that divide reformers.
I mean, I suppose it's certainly possible. I actually think the gun control debate is important in the education context and for terrible, terrible reasons that we all know about. We, as a country, in my opinion, don't do enough to regulate guns, but I realize that having that debate is controversial. So I don't know where to draw the line and say, oh, these issues don't belong in schools. I think that, teaching about climate change and teaching people about what's going on in their world is important. And I realize there's a diversity of opinions about all these issues. I just don't think that we should say, I mean, and again, this isn't so much about what's taught in the classroom. This was about whether ed reform should be leaning in on these issues, or whether it's just going to pull us away from the core issue of how to get schools better. And I guess my feeling is that if people want to talk about it, they felt the need to talk about it. And let's face it, it's not as if it's dominating the whole conversation. There's one panel that started that I think they should be allowed to talk about. They should be encouraged to talk about it because as both Rob and I agree, more diversity in the education reform movement is needed. We could speak to Robert's point about the suburban issue with charters, if you like. But Leave it to you.
So you're ending, the two of you agree on this? I'm surprised to hear that. I would think, Robert, you would be uncomfortable with more and more. You know, we had a lot of guidance letters from the U.S. Department of Education over the past administration on things like transgender bathrooms.
I've heard.
Pardon?
Yeah, I've heard about that, and that's where this gets uncomfortable for me. Not on that specific issue, but on the idea that we're going to dictate school policies and practices from thousands of miles away. Look, you know, I have very firm ideas about curriculum and instruction, both the classroom teacher, and I'm a longtime advocate for the work of Edie Hirsch Jr. and Core Knowledge curriculum, and because I just see that as sound literacy practice. So most of my career has been focusing on that issue as opposed to these issues that we're discussing today. That said, I find myself, the longer I go on in this work, less and less eager to impose my views of good practice on other people, and less confident, to be frank. You know, we're a big country. We're a big, diverse country. Even issues that Peter was just enumerating, like gun control and climate change, you're absolutely right, Peter. These are controversial issues. I am simply no longer confident as an educator in imposing my views on anything on kids. This is not to say that I don't bring my views into the classroom, but I teach in a school of choice. So that's the difference. It makes me really uncomfortable, since the vast majority of our kids do not have anything like choice, to have any kind of curricular instructional program dictated to them. I mean, you know, you can't ever forget that schools are functionally we have a coercive relationship with children. In other words, they have to attend. So if they have to attend, they have to be given choice.
Okay, and so just to wrap up this, you know, line of. Peter, is there anything that bothered you? Are you cool with the federal government determining transgender bathroom policies, for example, for all the schools in the country?
Did the federal government determine transgender bathroom policies?
They absolutely.
Did they offer guidance letter, yes. Offer some guidance? Did they offer guidance?
Yes.
Okay, so there's an issue. People are struggling with an issue. You have a federal government. The federal government offers guidance. Is that not an appropriate role for the federal government? Are you supposed to just say, we have nothing to do with this?
It depends on what happens when a school disregards the guidance, I imagine.
And what happens?
I don't know. You tell me. You were in that world, Peter.
I don't think a whole lot happens. I think that, for the most part, local control remains pretty much the rule around here. I think that the number of times where we really, really, really force changes on local schools is pretty, pretty small. And there's a long history in this country of needing that. I mean, there was a time when states and districts legally segregated, okay? Now, the federal government stepped in and said, this is wrong. There's a time when the education system really did not even try to address the needs of kids with disabilities, and the federal government finally stepped in and said, this is wrong. I'm hardly arguing for federal oversight of everything. I'm certainly not arguing for the federal government dictating curriculum. I think I heard those two words. I'm simply arguing for a reasonable level of protection for kids at risk, because we have an awful lot of kids at risk.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this during the No Child Left Behind waiver era, there was certainly it was floated out there that, you know, waivers could be withdrawn if the federal government wasn't happy with certain states' policymaking, and certainly Race to the Top was also part of that too, in terms of, you know, having pressure on, we believe you should do certain things a certain way, and if you do, you have a better chance of winning some free money. So,
well, that was a choice too, wasn't it? It was a choice program. Some states chose not to apply.
That's true.
Some states didn't win, and they were free to abandon the policies that they adopted in order to apply, and yet they kept them anyway.
I think people would say that the waivers were probably the more onerous of those two examples in terms of potential federal footprint.
Well, again, this was a choice. Some states chose to not to do them. Washington State didn't want to go along with the evaluation requirement, and so they said, no, we're not going to do it. So
the waivers, even though the waivers led to good things, things that I wanted to see in schools, the process, I will confess, may be uncomfortable. I say this to my civic students all the time, and this is not an original idea to me. I think it was Stephen Carter at Yale who says this. Imagine this power in the hands of your worst enemy. And then decide how you like it. So we like things like the waiver process, when it does things that we like, but eventually it's going to be in the hands of people whose ideas we do not like.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. I always make that point with mayoral control, that folks are comfortable with mayoral control if they like the mayor, and then right. if they don't like the mayor, suddenly they want elected school board. So
right, exactly.
So. I got it.
So the president-elect ran on, among other things, a $20 billion school choice block grant that could be given to states. No one's quite sure of all the details of that program. And if you guys are, we could break news here. So I guess just generally, though, as we head into a new administration, do you guys have any forecasting or tea leaf reading or something like that you could we'll start with Peter. What is going to happen with this school choice block grant? What would you like to see? What would you fear?
I'm guessing that nothing will happen. I mean, I think there's a zero chance he's going to get $20 billion in new money. So then he's going to have to take it from existing pots of money. And the existing pots of money are distributed by formula. And for all the rhetoric about, local control and not, liking competition or whatever. A lot of Republicans and the conservatives didn't like Race to the Top, didn't like the competitive grant program, and really liked formula funding. There's 435 members of Congress, 535 of the senators, and I'd like to see which one is going to raise their hand and say, you can take my formula funding away and put it towards this choice program.
Since you mentioned overall, if all the money stayed exactly the same and no levels changed, but they just included Title I portability, where families could get their low-income families could get their Title I federal funding directly and take it if they wanted to a private school, would we be expecting Peter Cunningham and Education Post to be opposing that?
I think that so the numbers are about what, $1,000 a kid, just from the federal money.
I think it varies, yeah, but
like that, 1,500 maybe. Mm-hmm. So we all know that that's probably not a lot of money and not enough to get you into most private schools. So again, maybe there's a small percentage of kids who are low income enough for whom that extra $1,500 will make a difference. I just don't think it will. And I think that most people, schools will resist strongly the idea that they don't have those guaranteed dollars for their low income kids. Mm-hmm.
And Robert, your thoughts on what we might be seeing with Betsy DeVos and
yeah, I have no special insight, probably, and I have probably poorer sources to lead me to those insights than Peter Cunningham does. I could think of worse ideas than a race to the top, a school choice race to the top, so to speak. Let me completely contradict myself, having said that I'm nervous about federal coercion. I can think of worse ideas than using a competitive grant process to incentivize individual states to really go more all in on choice. Everything. If you spend 20 minutes in education, you start to see these pendulum swings that go back and forth. I think if we're candid, those of us who call ourselves education reformers have to admit that at some level, and I think this conversation is indicative of that, we are at risk of becoming the blob. In other words, the blob, of course, meaning this huge regulatory infrastructure that we're becoming a little bit enamored of our own accountability measures, of data, of testing, of charter schools, etc. Nothing wrong with those things. I like them too, but at some point we start to protect those interests as opposed to the interests of children. So my one grand prediction, and it's not much of one, is I expect the pendulum to swing a lot more in favor of choice. I think the mood and the moment that's where we are as a country. And look, morally, I think that's where we are as a country. At some point, it just will not do to say to low-income parents, to any parent, frankly, look, trust us, we know what's best. We have not earned the right as reformers to say that to any parent of any income level.
I agree with you. I don't think that's the message that's certainly not the message I want to put out there, that trust us, we know best. I think I'm a lot closer to you than we all acknowledge in terms of wanting to trust parents, giving them as much freedom as possible to choose, and also being concerned that there's a lot of institutions in the education system that are not doing a great job and are not protecting kids who need protection. Mm-hmm. So I do think there is a pendulum effect that'll happen. I just think it's interesting. You look at a state like Georgia, where they voted down the authorization for the state to convert low-performing schools to charters. That's not exactly what the question was, but my sense is that's what people were voting on. And I thought that was interesting that, I don't know whether it was an anti-choice vote or an anti-state takeover vote, but, but it was an interesting thing to happen.
It does seem like both the Massachusetts and Georgia votes leaned one direction in the way that the, you know, Trump victory, I guess, leaned the other direction. Of course, you could bring in the popular vote into that. And my,
I'm not so sure about that, Bob. And I think what we're not recognizing here is that we as reformers have overplayed our hand somewhat. I think we are a little bit blithe about the deleterious effects of our reforms on the education that we give to our children. I guess Peter disagrees with me somewhat. But again, I come back to my experience as a teacher and as somebody who spends an extraordinary amount of time in schools on a daily and weekly basis.
To what negative reform do you refer? Like what?
Well, in other words,
effects of reforms?
As a practical matter, I think it's not unfair to say that those of us who call ourselves education reformers have pretty much called the tune for the last generation or more in American schools. We have had a disproportionate impact on educational practice through our policies, through No Child Left Behind, etc. I alluded to before, the testing tail is wagging the schooling dog. So I think that there is some reform fatigue, and the subtext to all this, I don't think we've really discussed this, Bob, is that if we are not careful here, if we do not give parents a much greater latitude than we have, there's a not non-trivial danger that we could lose all of this. In other words, here's the last thing I would want to see. The last thing I would want to see is doing away with testing. Testing gives us really valuable data that as a teacher, as a reformer, as a policy person, I do not want to live without that. If we continue to make these demands on schools around testing and continue to have that situation where, as I say, the testing tail is wagging the schooling dog, then it should surprise nobody if the opt-out movement, for example, continues to gather steam and we lose the entire apparatus. There's no accountability, there's no oversight at all. So I've been arguing for quite some time now that we need to uncouple those two ideas. Yes, let's have testing. We want that data, but let's use it to inform choice as opposed to for us to say who gets to choose what schools you get to choose from because of that testing, because of that data. I think we've just overplayed our hand.
Right.
Isn't it a good thing, though, that the new federal law specifically says when we, as states, devise accountability systems, make sure you look at multiple issues. Don't just look at testing.
Yeah, I agree. Testing is the easy thing to look at. So it will surprise nobody if a few years from now we're having the same conversation and parents are still upset about testing.
I mean, I would think that it gets more complicated in an ESA paradigm like in Arizona, where instead of individual schools, you may have people taking courses all kinds of different ways, online and through tutors and other ways. And we may see that, you know, the traditional school model breaking apart, where it's, you know, there's still, of course, could be tests, subject-based tests on however a kid's being educated, but I mean, there are, you know, the debate over whether private schools who accept vouchers should require testing is one that continues, and I don't know where the two of you stand on that. I suspect Peter would, to the extent he would even accept vouchers, would want to ensure that the schools take the same NCLB-type tests if they're receiving vouchers. Is that right, Peter?
I mean, to be honest, my opinion about them is admittedly kind of underformed. I know that is an issue, that there are a couple of states with vouchers that require some kind of test, either a norm reference test. This is language I don't really fully use very often. But and then I understand that there's a lot of others that don't. And what's the right thing to do? So if we allow kids to go to schools and they don't have a test, then we don't really know if they're at least learning the test or learning to pass the test.
Right.
But maybe we'll find in other ways. And maybe they're graduating and going to college and getting great jobs. So maybe that's another way to just look at it.
Okay.
One idea that I would love to see, and I'm just sucking this out of the end of my thumb. I don't even know if this is a real or practical idea, but I alluded to Pell Grants before. What if we came up with a similar system for K-12 education that rather than have annual tests, where those tests become the function of schools. If we accredited schools and allowed accredited schools to accept students and accept vouchers, this way you get the best of both. You're opening up a much broader marketplace of high quality schools, but you are uncoupling the deleterious impact of annual tests from those very good schools. So you're not asking them to do anything different than they are doing right now. Here in New York City, where I am, I mean, privileged parents have an enormous variety of schools to choose from. And they fetishize the difference between these schools like they're Talmudic scholars. I mean, if your kid is artistic, they go to St. Anne's. If they're athletic, they go to Poly Prep. If they're a brainiac, they go to Collegiate or Dalton or some such. I would love to see us get to a place where every parent has that those kinds of choices to the degree to which it's geographically possible, and that we don't upset that apple cart by making those schools be something other than what they are right now, which is generally broadly recognized to be outstanding schools. But we know they're outstanding schools because of the long-term results, because of the parent satisfaction, which we haven't even talked about, not because we test kids in these schools every year.
I would disagree. We know they're outstanding schools because we know about the SAT scores for the students.
That's fine. I'll accept that.
That wouldn't help for elementary school kids.
No, you need a different test beside SAT scores.
There's that slippery slope.
Or you could say, we're going to look at the SAT scores and back engineer to the schools they went to as kids and find out if they were really doing a decent job of preparing kids. And then we're going to get into all the debates about are they poor and do they have different disadvantages. I totally appreciate all those complexities. So I do not think it's perfect. I'm trying to imagine what life would be like without it. And it seems to me it would be worse.
I think what life would be like without it is...
I'm all about humility and having, you know, honest reflection about better ways to do accountability. I have an ongoing conversation with a whole bunch of teachers about this. If you don't want testing, what do you want? Mm-hmm. What should we hold ourselves accountable for, if not test scores? I'm wide open. It's hard to get really good, clear answers that feel muscular enough to build an accountability system on it. And again, remember, the point of accountability is that you have information that is valid enough for you to take action when necessary. That's what accountability means. And if, like a lot of teachers say, I just want to have classroom observations. I don't want to have test scores as part of my evaluation. Okay, well, are you comfortable then if a principal decides to take action against you based on those observations? Or are you going to start arguing that the principal's nuts? Because that's what they used to argue.
Yeah. Look, you know, I'm not Milton Friedman, but I'm not sure why we think that customer satisfaction is an effective accountability measure in every other line of good and service in America, but it shouldn't count for education. In other words, why do we immediately discount parental prerogative and the idea that the parent, by voting with their feet, that is a form of accountability?
I
oversimplify things, but I'm not sure why that's a bad idea.
I think it's a good idea. I just don't think it's, it has to act alone. I think it's a combination of that with objective verifiable data with various other factors. I think why not have it all? Why not use them both?
I would agree with you, except the having it all tends to, historically has tended to narrow choice and limit choice as opposed to creating more choice.
Let me close with something a little different, and now for something completely different, to quote Monty Python. So about a year ago, there was a case before oral arguments before the U.S. Supreme Court, the Friedrichs case, in which case it was widely assumed that the plaintiff, Rebecca Friedrichs, would prevail and compulsory agency fees for teachers' unions would be eliminated everywhere in the country. Then Justice Scalia died unexpectedly, and everyone assumed Hillary Clinton would be the next president, and this issue would be gone. Now, with the Trump election, and also with Republicans controlling the Senate, which confirms new U.S. Supreme Court appointments, suddenly now back on the table is this idea of a legal test to the idea of compulsory union fees, agency fees, as they're called. And there's a new case, the Janus case, coming out of Peter City of Chicago, in which a couple of plaintiffs are saying, we no longer want to pay these agency fees. We don't want to be involved with the unions at all. And so now with the a potential new composition of the U.S. Supreme Court, this could mean that by, I'm told, around 2018 would be the earliest it could be heard, but that we could have a scenario in which teachers in all states, like the 26 right-to-work states, would be able to fully opt out of the unions completely in major states where they can't now, like California, Illinois, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Massachusetts. So, Peter, what would that be a good thing? What do you think about compulsory union fees for teachers who want no association?
Well, I think that in situations where teachers are benefiting from their relationship with the union, i.e. they're getting benefits and salary hikes, I think they ought to contribute to that union for that. I think that the issue was about whether they should contribute for political activities of the union. I think there's it's a good question. I'm not a legal scholar. My sense is that the union ought to separate those two things. And if they want to run a political arm, that they can have a political arm and raise funds for it. And if they want to run a collective bargaining operation in order to give teachers their pay and benefits, that people who benefit from that ought to contribute to that.
So, I mean, that's the current precedent, the Abood case, calls for the unions separating their checkbooks into purely political activities and allegedly apolitical activities. But the plaintiffs are saying that this distinction is a false one, and they claim that their free speech rights means that they shouldn't have to pay for any kind of union activity they don't believe in. But anyway, Robert, your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I don't have a strong feeling on this. Ironically, even though I was a union member, I never paid, and I paid the dues, I never joined the unions, but I'm not a union basher, for what it's worth. Not to suggest that I think that they are always on the side of the angels in education, but nor if you gave me a magic wand to wave at things in American schools, they would be, you know, not near the top of my list in terms of things that I want to correct. My issue with unionization more broadly is, and this is of a piece with our conversation about choice, it tends to create the condition that creates a certain amount of sameness across schools. So in that regard, it is, I don't want to say the enemy of, but works against innovation, experimentation, and whatnot. So I have no dog in this fight. My read is similar to yours, Bob. I think the Trump presidency and the presumably coming 5-4 conservative majority will be bad news for unions. I'm not sure what their response will be, but I'm sure there will be a response.
Mm-hmm. And you say you don't have a dog. Pardon, Peter?
I said I support unions. Just so you know, it doesn't mean I think they need to be everywhere. I don't think they need to be in all the charter schools. But I generally feel that
in Maryland, where they are in all the charter schools.
Yes, I understand. But for the most part, they aren't mandatory. They're only in 10 or 12%. And I think that. You know, it's up to the teachers in those schools to make those decisions and the people who run those schools. But I think that I'm not against them.
Mm-hmm. And so I was going to say, Robert, you said you don't have a dog in that fight, but you do have a dog, right? Haven't we been hearing a dog?
I'm so sorry. Yes, here at the New York office of the Fordham Institute, my kitchen, my dog is at my feet. And
Can you hold up the dog just so we can see?
I'm not sure how well she's going to take to this.
But all right. What's her name?
This is Luna. She's a Boston Terrier.
Is she well behaved or generally obstreperous?
Not today, but my daughter's coming home from college tomorrow, and while she looks forward to seeing her parents, she mostly wants to see this little critter.
Okay. And Peter, before we close, were you at all involved in the, I don't know if you read this in the papers, the Chicago Cubs apparently won the World Series. Was this something you were involved in at all?
But they lost the popular vote.
I was actually abroad during that World Series, and I was in Europe, and I was waking up at 3 a.m, and I couldn't stream it, so I literally was just clicking refresh, refresh, refresh after every pitch. And I lost a lot of sleep, but it was pretty exciting.
So you are you're a hardcore fan. You are a Cubs fan. I just assumed, for all I knew, you're a Cubs fan.
Yeah, I'm kind of a fair weather sports fan. I'm not a big sports guy, but it was great. It was great for Chicago. It was really fun to see. And I've been to a bunch of games at Wrigley Field, and it's a special experience. So
my response to the whole thing is free Bartman. You know, the guy that messed up with that foul ball and had to, you know, go underground and had death threats and all this stuff. Like, now, yeah. If you ask me, he should throw out the first pitch at the beginning of next season. How about that idea?
That's a great idea. I like that idea.
All right. Yeah. I want to thank Robert Pondiscio of the Fordham Institute and Peter Cunningham of Education Post for this live chat. And, gentlemen, it was a pleasure. And so I hope we do it again soon. Meanwhile, yes, have a nice night. We'll see you later.
Merry Christmas, all. Be well.
See you.